always say, man, if you change somebody's day, you might just change their life.
This is how I went down. I said, dude, just give me $2,500, Van Juris.
I want to see JR walking around the parking lot with no shirt on it.
We're going to be high-tech rednecks before this is all said and done.
Justin, hey, you passed out under your desk.
My favorite part of this is that Justin got too drunk to finish.
Well, we'll put you down if you give me half a chance.
It's been your pleasure. Bang!
Check, check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Everything's working once again this week. Welcome, everyone, to this installment of the Justin Moore Podcast. This is episode 12 of season 2 of said podcast. And I'm your old buddy, your old pal, JR the Handler. And with me is the namesake of this podcast, Edgard from Poland, Arkansas, the Indians' starting point guard, Justin Moore. What's up, JM?
What's up, buddy? Good morning, afternoon almost. Not a whole lot going on here, except it is freezing cold. I mean, it is so cold here, like cold.
Yeah. It's cold here too, which is abnormal for even down here this time of the year. I think I woke up and it was 30.
Yeah, it's not, I mean, it's supposed to get back up into the high 50s, low 60s. But whoo, it's been, yeah. I've been picking up from Thanksgiving and stuff outside, and I told Kate the other day, I'm like, I got to wait till it warms up. I mean, it's just too cold for me, a sissy with cold weather.
Oh, yeah, know? I was going to say, you don't like it. Yeah. Well, and you know my dad, he doesn't like it nowadays because it makes his hands hurt and stuff, and he actually had some surgeries he was supposed to do a few weeks ago, and he moved them to next week because he wanted to get all his gardening and stuff in before the weather got cold on him. He said, I got stuff I need to do now for it gets cold. I'm just going to push this rotator cuff surgery back. And I'm like, don't push it, Dad. Don't go out there and hurt something else on that. So anyway,
right?
Yeah, and I kind of didn't get ahead of it myself. I wish I'd have done a few things before it got this cold. But hey, here we are. It's winter in the South, and I guess we'll get a little gust here and there. I saw Jeff, our production manager, putting pictures up. I guess they had a lot of snow up in Tennessee this past. Or at least the last night or so.
They did. I spoke with Pete, and he said they were getting snow. And of course, we don't really get that. We it rained a couple days ago, but usually they get the weather right like a day after we get it. I guess that's just the pattern, you
right?
Kind of due east and north of us, however many miles it is, but. But yeah, we got rain, and I guess it gets a little chillier there than it does here. It's about 8 degrees difference usually on average, or something like that, from where I'm from to there, and so.
Well, hey, normally we BS for a little while before we bring our guest on, but I'm more excited for this guest than any guest we've had on. I love all our brothers that we've had on so far and all of our friends, but this one is really special for you and I, and we just came up with this, and I'm glad he reached back out and made this happen. But without further ado, he's on the Zoom machine holding pattern here, so let's bring him to the podcast. I don't even know how I make that. I can't believe at 41 I'm getting to make this introduction. Welcome, everyone, to the podcast. You know him as Bo Duke, the one and only John Schneider. There he is.
Hey,
buddy, we got you on sideways.
Wait, there you go. I got you right here in my ear.
He looks a lot more professional than we do right now, to be honest with you.
You're sideways.
No, I'm here. Look at my hair.
That's why we wear caps too, brother.
Well, it's an absolute pleasure to meet you. I mean, it's an odd way to meet people, obviously, in this strange time, but. We certainly are appreciative of you spending a little time with us as huge fans of your music and your acting over the years. I can't tell you how many times I've hurt myself trying to slide across the hood of my dad's pickup truck trying to be you. So it's a pleasure to have you. Thank you so much.
I heard Luke and Bo in the song. That's the first time I haven't gotten top billing.
We'll have to get on the songwriters for that one.
Yeah,
a lot of things rhyme with Bo.
There you go.
Luke is a tough one. Puke. Maybe. I don't know.
John, do you got your we're looking at you sideways. Are you
want me this way?
If you can. Ah, there we go. Is that better? Is that okay for you?
Yeah, I got to put you I've got you on a box on a table. So there's so much for my professionalism.
Hey, I've got encyclopedias that I never read under my computer as well, brother.
The dustiest part of the house.
Yeah. There you go. Hey, you know, it's funny, before we start talking about the Bo and Luke thing, Justin's longtime producer and songwriting partner, Jeremy Stover, has twin boys. And this is a true story, and his wife's going to...
Oh, no.
Yeah, his wife's going to give me a hard time, and he's going to give me a hard time for this, because we've never really officially talked about it. But on the bus one day, a couple of years ago, he comes on the bus, and he's like, I got something I want to tell you guys, but nobody knows, so don't tell anyone, but Miley's pregnant again, and we're having twins, and it's going to be boys. And the first thing I thought of is any Southern
man. And he's from Georgia.
He's from North Georgia.
Yeah.
So I say, of course, well, of course you're going to name them Bo and Luke, right? And he thought about it for a second, and he said, I had to think about that. Well, turns out he named them Bo and Luke. He really did name them Bo, because I'm like, if they're two boys from Georgia, you got to name Bo and Luke. So he did, and his wife didn't like it, and he told me I couldn't say that I was the one that came up with the name. It had to be their idea. So sorry, Miley, but that was all Uncle JR for Bo and Luke.
Now it's out. You know, it's so funny. When Nicolas Cage named his son Kal-El, I thought he was crazy. But somebody naming their twins Bo and Luke makes perfect sense to me.
That's what I thought. even though you were cousins on the show, but
Thank you for getting that right. A lot of people get that wrong.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I'm of the age. Yeah. I've got a picture of my grandmother giving me my first guitar when I was 3 years old, and it is a Dukes of Hazzard plastic guitar with you guys' face in the car.
That's great.
And I've still got it. Actually, I don't have the original one. I lost it, but I had the picture, and our bus driver, Mark, went out and sought out one and got me one off eBay or somewhere and got me one for Christmas last year. So I've got a remake
of
my original.
Cool.
Yeah, it really
is. Very, very cool.
It is very cool. Speaking of the Dukes of Hazzard, I mean, I'm sure you've talked about it for years and decades now, but obviously having a hit TV show is incredibly difficult to do, especially the longevity. But could you ever foresee like the impact that it's had, even beyond the years that stayed on TV, whether it be current or reruns? I mean, the impact, it just seems so rare to have a show, and there are obviously some out there, but the impact that it's had just for decades and for generations of people, it just is huge.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. I think for the last, probably for 50 years, but certainly for the time since Dukes of Hazzard's been on, the whole Hollywood community does not understand that there are more people that live at the end of a dirt road than live on the fourth floor of a high rise. They just don't get it.
Right.
So when we were doing Dukes of Hazzard, of course, we were the bastard child of CBS. Nobody ever claimed to have anything to do with Dukes because we were that rural car comedy. Which, by the way, is what Stand On It is and what Smokey and the Bandit was, which made $360 million before VHS, right?
Yeah.
But I think I'm from New York, but I'm from a very rural part of New York. It's actually a village, the village of Mount Kisco. So I went to middle school on a dirt road. So I understand that. I understand community. I understand the need for friendship, and I understand the need to be a good friend, right?
Yep.
I've never thought I lived on an island, and the island was called John, and you were lucky to be on it. And a lot of people feel that way.
Oh, I'm sure in Hollywood, no doubt.
But you know, let's leave the Democrat socialists out of this for a moment. I don't. At 18, I never. I mean, it never occurred to me that I'd be talking about the Dukes of Hazzard 40 years later, 42 years later. Probably never occurred to me I'd be alive 42 years later. But having lived it, it makes perfect sense to me. We've been doing a drive-in tour with our music. We brought the Redneck Rebel and then all the music from Stand On It. We've been playing drive-ins. We played one night before last. We played two this weekend, one in Centerville, one in Sparta. And people show up who are just ready to laugh and enjoy one another again, who are enraged by the notion that there's a governor somewhere that can limit the number of people we have in our Thanksgiving celebration.
Amen.
Yes, no doubt. So, ridiculous.
So knowing what I know, traveling how I travel, having lived in Nashville, having lived mostly, I live on a dirt road, not in Nashville, but it's no surprise to me, because everything I see as we're driving to the drive-ins, everything you see, I'll bet, looks exactly like Hazzard County, mm-hmm. which looks exactly like it did in 1978 when the show was, 79 when the show was first aired. We filmed in 78. So those people's view and their perception of community hasn't changed. And thank God it hasn't changed.
Agreed.
So I'm not surprised at all that Dukes of Hazzard and the Andy Griffith Show are still people's favorites. I'm just delighted to have been on one that falls in that category. I think Smallville kind of falls in that category too.
Yeah,
yeah, a modern take on it. But yeah, you're right. And that's what, you know, we've said that before. You know, when you go, like first time we traveled, Justin's from Central Arkansas. I was born in Jackson, Mississippi, grew up outside of Montgomery, Alabama.
Oh, yeah, we just drove through. Yeah.
Yeah. I've been keeping up with you on your stuff, and I actually watched the movie last night. Phenomenal. Oh. Loved it. Yeah, it was great, man. Loved it, bro. I want to talk. We'll talk about that for sure. And we'll make sure to put links up on all that and everything.
Oh, thank you.
Because I know all our fans will love it. I know one fan right now that's losing his mind, and it's our buddy Paul Rogers, because the two things, he's one of our longtime listeners to this, but his two favorite things in the world are the Dukes of Hazzard and Justin Moore podcast. So he's losing his mind right now. And I saw he actually had commented on the movie on the Vimeo page and stuff, and you responded to him, so I know he's pumped about that.
Yeah, yes. Oh, he's
so
terrific.
That was, yeah, it was very cool. So, but yeah, the first time we ever traveled out of the South when Justin became an artist and I became a tour manager, going to LA or going to California, not necessarily LA, but California or New York, you know, growing up down here, we didn't really even know there were country people outside of the country people we grew up around, just because I never left my county until I was, you know, 17 really or whatever. Then the first time I went to California, I'm in Northern California on a 9,000 acre ranch with a guy I used to work for, John Party. And I'm like, I thought California was like skateboards and bikinis. And he's like, no, that's just down there. He said, up here,
we're a little tiny part.
Yeah. He's like, up here, we're cowboys, man. It's ranching. It's, you know, real ranch stuff. And then same thing in New York. The first time I went to New York and played a show in upstate New York, there was 15,000 people there. And I'm like, I didn't even know people like country, rural music up here. But that's because I was, you know, I didn't know. I wasn't traveled yet. I wasn't experienced in the world. I didn't know there was more outside of New York City when you get up in the Catskills and just the beautiful hills and up there and stuff. So yeah, it there's a lot more than people give us credit for. And as far as attention and people wanting that, yeah, that's why those shows lasted so long, because they look like us. They sound like us, you know.
Well, that's why country music is so important. It's why country music is so relevant. And it's why older folk, I lived with Johnny Cash for a year and a half. So I'm an older guy. And my first number one song was 87. That was wonderful. Got a picture of Johnny and I somewhere.
Oh, my God. Another Arkansas boy.
Yeah, that's right.
You just gotta have stories upon stories from that year and a half.
My stories have stories, yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah. But you know, I was introduced to music through two people. My uncle, who had cerebral palsy, and his best friend was a turntable. He would listen to music all day. And my dad, who played in a square dance band called the Crop Dusters. And I play his electric, his Music Man guitar on stage.
Oh, wow.
And I remember how important music was to our folks in rural New York. And it made a great impression on me. At least once a year, my dad would play for he did a lot of square dances, but he would play for a wheelchair square dance.
Wow.
So talking about the importance of community and the importance of music, And me being a little kid and watching my dad bring joy. And my dad was not, I mean, that's just something he and his friends did as a hobby. But being able to bring that kind of joy to folks in wheelchairs in rural New York really made a great impression on me. And I think that's why I tend to skew toward making music and movies about, I don't want to say that people in the city aren't real, and I don't want to say that they don't work, but it's different. It's different. I think people in rural communities, and especially in the South, really understand that they require relationship in order to get through not only the tough times, but the good times too.
Yeah.
You know, you don't want to get through good times alone either. So I'm very thankful for my upbringing, and I love the fact that Dukes of Hazzard is still a big part of people's world, even though the crazy people have taken it off the air.
Oh, makes me this whole we've talked about this. Hey, there he is.
Hey, well, we're still putting it in songs.
Yeah,
we're still putting it in songs.
I've got it on my car. Yeah, I'm sure you noticed when you watched Stand On It, I've got it on the front of my car, and I've got it behind Cody McCarver, and he's driving the truck down the road.
Oh, yeah. It's
so not
it's,
only did I not take it off, but I put it on.
You doubled it.
I'm a Yankee.
I'm a recovering Yankee.
Did you fall in love with music or acting first, or was it just purely you just fell in love with entertainment, period? Entertaining people.
Storytelling. I used to watch the Johnny Cash show. I think it was Saturday nights, with my grandmother. But I would say that that music was my first love, and I got that took me at 8 years old into community theater doing musicals. So by the time Dukes of Hazzard came around, I'd probably done 15 plays, and I bet at least half of those were musicals. So I really considered myself a singer who acts, not an actor who sings.
Right. Well, it's such a rare feat. I didn't mean to interrupt. It's such a rare feat to have so much success in both.
Yeah.
You know,
you have to work it.
Quite an accomplishment on your part.
Well, thank you. But you have to really, work it. And that was in the days before anyone had really crossed over. Reba hadn't happened yet. Billy Ray hadn't happened yet. Willie hadn't done The Redheaded Stranger yet. You know, it's talk about a long time ago.
Yeah,
right.
So I tell people, they say, what do you like more? And I love doing movies because I can put my music in my movies. I can't put my movies in my music.
Right.
So all the music you heard on Stand On It last night is all the stuff that Cody McCarver and myself and Keith Burns have done specifically for the movie. So now we are cross-promoting. In the old days was to try to put a little pop sound in your music or a little rock and roll sound in your music. But now for me, our music helps sell our movies and our movies help sell our music. So I'm very excited, and you know, the world fell apart this year, but one thing that did not come out of Hollywood was any new content whatsoever.
None.
So we have the only new content. So it's conceivable that we will be, I guess it's not hard to be the most successful movie of 2020 if you're the only movie of 2020. But,
supply and demand, baby.
I'll still put it on the T-shirt.
Yeah, right. Well, yeah, exactly. You know, during this whole time, we've only done about 5 shows in about the past 6 months. You know, we did it right at the beginning.
Wild?
It's the we usually do about 100, and where Justin's at in his career, we'd only do about 100 shows a year. And we're gonna by the time it's over, we've got one show next week at Billy Bob's in Fort Worth, and after that, we will have done 12 shows in 12 months, and that is a record. But going back to what you said earlier, yeah, the few shows we have done have been in rural America, you know, mostly all outside, but there's been thousands of people. everyone happy, everyone smiling, and like you said, just the joy it brings people to be able to get together and party and mingle and listen to live music is just invaluable. And I know when all this shakes out, there's going to be a lot more than our financial crisis we're in because of this scare tactics they've used to trick us into all thinking this is what we need to
do. Oh, it's just awful. When I think about the number of freedoms we have given up since we gave up our right to peaceful assembly. We do a thing every year called Bo's Extravaganza. I'd love to have you guys at Bo's Extravaganza.
Absolutely, yeah.
We're there.
When I told people on my Facebook and on YouTube, you know, come hell or high water, we're doing this in April of 2020. And then all of a sudden, it started to look like, because the president started to get in, and we were really not sure what it was at that point. So we moved it to July, and that's, you saw that in Stand On It, where we had, right, had about 4,000 people. Last year we had 10, you know, next year we'll probably have 15. But I wanted to make sure that people understood that we moved it because I didn't want to appear to be doing anything in opposition to our president. Because I would not do that. So when he said we need to time out, we need to figure this out before anybody has any events anymore, that's why we moved it. I felt the need to say that because there were some, you know, that they say your career is over when your stalker quits. Well, right. Your career is over if you don't have haters, if you don't have trolls on Facebook and on Twitter and on YouTube, then you're probably not saying much.
Yeah,
so, passion. Passion. Yeah,
that's the new definition, so, for sure.
I saw a video of you talking about that, John, and just so you know, in complete transparency, JR and I see the world through the same lens as you on most every front. Yep. So you're not going to say, and our listeners, that would say to a large degree also. So, but you touched on rights being taken away. My manager, JR's my road manager. My manager grew up in Jersey and moved down to Nashville 25 years ago or something like that. He's like you. He said, yeah, I'm a Southerner now. he don't talk like it. He talks like, hey, what are you kidding me?
Give me some coffee.
Yeah.
I'm from Jersey.
It took us a while to learn to understand each other. He was going, spit it out, man. Come on with it, you know. And I'm going, you got to slow down. I listen about as slow as I talk, you know. but he told me years and years ago, we were talking about politics, and this was, I mean, 20 years ago maybe or something. And he's like, you would be amazed if you really stopped and thought about how many rights have been taken away from us. He said, since I was your age, you know, and he's close to 70, I'm close to 40 now. And to your point, it's just continued slowly, slowly, slowly. And then you look up and you go, holy cow, man. You know, and I know you were speaking on specifics to this particular year, but if you look back on it, though, over the last 30 years or whatever, I mean, it's crazy if you think about it.
It's been a slow erosion of our rights, but I do think this year we chose, which is classic literature and classic war tactics, divide and conquer, bring something up that appears to be in the name of the public good so that the public will bow to your demands or your mandates. When pastors decided to close their churches, and to me, and I have many friends who were pastors, and I've told them all, what that says to me is that your governor is bigger than your God. If I was a pastor, I would rather preach. You have a right to be in my congregation or come to my church or not. But I don't have the right not to preach a sermon if I'm a pastor. I don't have that choice. I would rather preach a sermon to an empty room who chose to be empty than close down my church because some elected official,
yeah, right,
told me I had to. So we've given up a lot, and it's it's a lot harder to get them back than it is to give them up.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're in very interesting times right now. I, for one, and I have many liberal friends who think I'm out of my mind, and that's okay because I think they're out of their mind. We can still have a beer.
Right.
I believe that the president and Jay and Rudy and the generals, I believe we got this because I do not believe anywhere in my recovering Yankee or my adopted Southern soul that there is such thing as an acceptable level of cheating. There is no acceptable level of cheating. So we're going to see. We have time. There's a number of days, if not weeks, left before any real decisions will be made or any real races will be called. And I choose to continue to support whom I feel has been the best. I'm 60. And who I feel has been the best president of my lifetime. Wow. And until otherwise, that's who I'm for, and that's who I believe will continue to be in the White House and continue to fight for people who live at the end of a dirt road.
Yep.
And people who live on the fourth floor of a high rise. That is a man who works for the people and knows it. He has the highest office of public servitude in the world, and he knows it.
Yep.
Yeah, and like you said, with the preacher and the congregation, we feel the same way. Like with our job, we would rather go play a show and no one show up than everyone be told they can't. We'd rather we want to make that decision for ourselves. If Justin said it on here before and in some other interviews, national interviews, that we would like to have the choice. If we feel comfortable enough to go play the show, we should be able to go play the show. And if you feel comfortable enough to come see the show, you should be able to. And if you don't, then you don't. But I'm not going to make you come to the show. We're not going to make you not come to the show. It's up to you, personal decision. But that has
weaned. You have to be willing to lose money.
Yeah.
Well, you have to be willing to lose money to do the show. We do that. We make our own movies. We've lost our shirts so many times. But we continue to do it. I did 10 albums for MCA, and some of them did great. One was a number one album. One was a top 10, you have to keep doing it, go. And then when something works, like Stand On It is doing great. When something works, people will go back and they will, they'll listen to your other music. So if you go play to an empty field, enough people will know that you did that because it is your right as an American citizen, and it is in many regards your obligation as a performer. We work for people who buy seats and who buy downloads and who buy records. That's who we work for. We don't work for labels or movie studios. Those people will come back the next time tenfold. You just have to believe it. It's kind of like the loaves and fishes. You just have to believe it.
Yep.
Yep. Yeah, well, I will say this. To your sentiment about the election and your thoughts on the president and all of those things, I just want to say from an entertainer perspective, I admire you for being so upfront and honest and vocal and being brave, to be honest with you. To for somebody like me, I see it as being brave because – as we all know, any place in the entertainment business doesn't believe, for the most part, the way that you and I and JR believes. Again, right. They don't necessarily see the world through the same lens as we do. So for me, I've always been told, just kind of keep quiet. Just bite your tongue. And, and so I just want to, I just want to say I admire you as an entertainer for being so brave about that when it could have had negative effects on your career or fallout in some way or the other. But I believe that to me is kind of the mark of patriotism.
It's patriotism, and in many regards, it's why I was Bo. One of the first lines of dialogue I had in the very first episode, One Armed Bandits, I said to the young lady, I said, I choose this life. not because I don't know any better, but because I believe it is better. And I'm not going to let anybody pollute the well where I drink. John Schneider believed that long before Bo Duke said it. I'm pigheaded, I'm stubborn, but I tell you, I do not hold anything against people who disagree with me at all. I feel I have a right to speak the way I feel, to speak my heart. I feel they have the right to do that too. But my gosh, you got to draw a line when people start breaking windows and burning things. Yeah. That's got to stop.
Yeah.
And the reason I believe, another reason why I believe that that President Trump will have the next 4 years as well, is because I do believe that the United States of America is a country built by God. Built not only with God's design,
Amen.
But with God's permission and his blessing. And this most noble experiment will go away if this travesty and this cheating is allowed to prevail. So I don't believe for a moment that that's going to happen.
I hope you're right, brother, for sure.
Hey, can I tell people where they can get Stand on It?
Yes, please.
Absolutely.
I want to talk a little bit about the whole thing on the movie too. If you want to lead into that,
I know we don't have a ton of time.
Jay Sekulow is the president's lawyer, and I've known Jay for 35 years.
Oh, cool.
So I'm going to do his show right after this because he's running around like crazy trying to save our republic.
Yeah, no doubt. Well, I'll run through these quick little things I wanted to hit on. Talking about Stand on It, the movie that's out now that we can find, and we'll let everybody know where they can get that.
Excellent.
But going back to early, you're born in New York, but you moved to Georgia as a teenager. Is that correct?
14. My mother 14. Worked for IBM. I moved to Atlanta when I was 14.
Gotcha. Okay. And then part of the reason you went back and did Stand on It, which is a modern take with some. My interpretation is a modern take on Smokey and the Bandit, as if it was really a movie and you're living the life now as a television star, stuntman, and going back and doing the movie. But the reason that always stuck with you, I've read this in an interview, that you snuck on the set of Smokey and the Bandit as an extra.
I did.
And see, that struck a chord with me and talking about the movie thing, because I was doing background acting in New Orleans. My wife and Justin's wife both are from Houma, Louisiana, which is down south of New Orleans.
Fantastic. Okay,
right. So
sure.
My wife and I just moved back to Gulf Shores, Alabama, which is how you and I connected through my friend Brandon, who is one of my fraternity brothers who runs the Floribama now, who you're friends with.
Thank you,
Brandon, for connecting us.
Hey, Brandon.
Yeah, thanks,
Hi,
buddy. Yeah, big Earl. Don't offend anybody, Jack. Jack, another Arkansas guy. But
buddy.
But so I've done the background acting thing, is where I was going, that in New Orleans, and I was on a big Ben Affleck movie doing a bunch of work, and it got shut down the same week we got shut down on the road, and they still haven't opened that back up.
Yeah.
They've opened a few movies or television shows when quarantine and all that stuff. But I know you've been working your tail off. You've put out music and a movie and other stuff during
just
that time.
Did it. You know, we just we decided that nothing was going to stop us. After we moved the Bo's Extravaganza, we decided, okay, that's it. We're not going to bow to any of this anymore. We only had about 7 days where we actually had a crew. So the rest of the time, it's me and the Hellcat and a friend of mine operating the camera. And I drive by 110 miles an hour, right?
No
and then
fun
I come
there.
Back, and then I come back and I get in the hell. I'm sorry. Then I come back and I get in one of the police cars, change my hat, and drive by 100. So a lot of the times in the movie, I'm chasing myself.
Oh,
wow.
Okay. Yeah. Well, it looked great, man. The movie. I mean, the cinematography on it. It looked amazing. The sound was great. I love the songs you played throughout. It was kind of, some of those were kind of the same as the movie. They were takes on other songs and plays on other songs.
Yep.
Some of them.
Yeah.
And I got to say, I know that it was based in Louisiana, as you said on there, Baton Rouge. And I knew the bridge and everything when it started going. I was like, I feel like I'm going back to my wife's neck of the woods.
I love that. That's
great. And that's where your studio. Do you live there now? Outside of Baton Rouge, is that where you're at full time now?
Yeah, we live in Holden. It's Holden, which is in Livingston Parish, and I'm here right now. I'm in our screening room. This was a YMCA camp from about 1935 until 1980 or so, called Camp Singing Waters. I bought it in 2011. I first came here to film a horror comedy called Smothered, and I fell in love with the diversity of it. We've got a river, which we jumped the car over. We've yep. got two beautiful lakes. We've got swamps. We've got cypress knees. We've got pine trees and bamboo. We've got everything that Louisiana has to offer right here in this 150-acre piece of property.
Oh, wow. And that's basically between Hammond and Baton Rouge, right? It and Holden somewhere?
Yeah, it's like right in the middle, right gotcha. In between Hammond and Baton Rouge. We go to Hammond a couple times a week. Great food in Hammond now.
Oh, yeah.
We've got wonderful restaurants in Hammond.
Yeah, I've seen the Holden exit off of there.
Yeah, I wanted to celebrate Louisiana for everybody. And folks listening, watching, I play a guy who gets – I play basically me. I'm a guy that was on a television show that's known for driving and a stuntman. And I get bet $500,000 that I can't do for real what Burt Reynolds pretended to do in Smokey and the Bandit.
I love it.
And it's fun. And I'm one of those guys who saw Smokey and the Bandit. I mean, I was 16 when I snuck on the set. The movie came out in 77. I probably saw it 50, 60 times in the theater.
Wow.
And then 2 years later, in 78, I was on the set filming Dukes of Hazzard. So it was a very short amount of time from the ballsy kid who climbed over a fence and tapped a guy on the shoulder and said, "Hey, man, I'm sorry I'm late, but traffic on I-85 is a bear. Where's hair and makeup?"
That was Bo.
That was it.
That's Bo. Right.
I thought when I read that, I thought, I'm going to use that. The next time they don't need me, I'm going anyway, and I'm just going straight to the tent and getting standing in line and getting ready.
Yeah.
Well,
Make sure you're a little late. Make sure you're like in between. Odd numbers are important. It's got to be like 9:47. You know, you got it. Odd numbers. Remember that.
Being a tour manager, I'm not the most punctual one, so I'm sure I got that part down pat for sure.
I wanted to say, too,
real quick, I know that was Louisiana, and I had one other main question about the intro. The announcer at the show, is that Johnny Lee?
Johnny Lee. Yes.
I knew that was Johnny Lee. I knew that. I was thinking, is that Johnny? Because I saw Johnny probably 10 years ago. We played up the street, and a friend of mine owned a bar in Tuscaloosa, and I went down and watched him and thought, man, that sure looks like Johnny Lee. That's the same hat he had on. So anyway, I thought that
was
him.
Love Johnny Lee. We did use Johnny Lee in a movie we did 2 years ago called Four to Go, and it's like a psychological thriller. Johnny Lee is a posse, the head of a posse chasing Buff Bagwell through Louisiana.
Oh God!
So check that out too. And then last year when we did Christmas Cars, Johnny's got that wonderful speaking voice. So we use Johnny as our version of Waylon, the balladeer.
Yeah.
On Christmas Cars. So check that out too. Yeah, we love Johnny. He's doing better. He had a pretty rough bout in the last year with some surgeries and some things, but he's doing really great. He's a handful. Johnny
Lee. I can imagine. Yeah, the one time I met him, he was still kicking.
He rewrote Looking for Love for Four to Go, because he's a posse, he's chasing somebody. He rewrote and re-sang, it's Looking for Thugs in All the Wrong Places. Looking
for Thugs. That's good stuff.
Oh, gosh.
That's good stuff. But I know you got to go, and I hate we're short on time, but I understand obligations. But I want to definitely extend an offer next year, because we've got three more episodes of this season coming out. We're going to take a break for the holidays, and we're going to come back next year.
Okay.
So come back on with us again so we can do a long – because we usually do an hour or so. So come back on with us next year, and we'll do a long version, and hopefully we're doing shows by then, and you could come to a show where we're playing or vice versa, and we can do it in person.
I want you to come to Bo's. I would love for you to come to Bo's Extravaganza. It's a kick. It'd just be like coming home.
Yeah, it's close. And Justin's in Arkansas. That's probably only, 3 or 4 hours from you, Just, maybe?
I'm where South Arkansas starts or Central Arkansas stops, whatever you want to say. But I just want to say, and we'll get you out of here, get you out of here with this. I appreciate you taking the time. I know you've got a ton of things you could be doing right now. This is such a thrill for JR and I as fans of not only your music, but your acting and all of the great work that you do. And again, I just want you to know how much I appreciate the example that you've set for conservative people like me in the entertainment industry and your patriotism. And hopefully we'll have the opportunity to meet in person one day, maybe get up and play some music together at some
Absolutely.
Point.
But I would love it.
Can't
love
thank you
music.
Enough.
Love your music.
Thank
love
you so
your
much.
Sensibilities. And don't ever let anybody push you off top dead center, because that's where you are.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Very kind of you.
Hey, thank
and,
you, gentlemen.
And do you want to tell everybody real quick where they can get the movie? I know there's a
sure.
whole treasure trove of different movies you've put out on Vimeo.
You can rent Christmas Cars. You can rent Stand On It. All those are at Cineflix, D-O-D. That's C-I-N-E-F-L-I-X, D-O-D. Or if you'd like to get a hold of the DVD, it's johnschneiderstudios.com. If you want to listen to music, go. I was just listening to you guys. I was listening to Justin on Spotify. Go to Spotify and look up the Redneck Rebel. I think you'll enjoy that. Redneck Rebel is pretty darn good.
There you go.
So there you go. Those are all my places.
Awesome.
And I appreciate it. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Happy birthday.
You
Gather
too.
With as many people as you wish. And
no doubt about
a stranger.
It.
Be an outlaw. Shake somebody's hand today.
I love it. Yeah,
thanks
y'all go
so
check John out
day.
On all social media outlets. Go to johnschneiderstudios.com. Thank you again, John Schneider. Pleasure to meet you, brother. We'll talk soon.
Pleasure to meet you, too. You take care. Bye-bye.
All right, buddy. Thank you, brother.
Thanks, man.
Okay. Well, there you go. That was Bo Duke, everybody.
I mean, I was trying to find another mic to drop. I mean... I don't know what to do with myself.
I mean, I have a million. Like we talked briefly before the show started. I'm excited to talk to all our friends, but I never met John, and I have so many questions. I usually don't have any. We just kind of riff, but I'm like, this is Bo Duke. I have got a gajillion questions for this guy. But we didn't even get into half of them. I wanted to know about his hanging with all the different country stars over the years.
I mean, we could talk to him, JR, for 12 hours.
Yeah, well, good thing is...
He lived with Johnny Cash for a year and a half. I mean,
no,
are you kidding me?
We could
do 3 hours on that.
Exactly. So, I hope he seems like he's down and he's a talker. So, we got to definitely get him back on next season to talk again more of that kind of stuff, because that was fantastic. So, I hope everybody out there enjoyed that as much as we did. That was the fabulous John Schneider, one of the hardest working guys during quarantine, and I like his point of view. He said we just did it
yeah,
just go.
Yep.
Just do
well
it.
You know, it's you mentioned it to me off air. You said he's done more during 9 months of quarantine than you and I've done in 5 years.
He's had 3 movies come out, 2 records.
Yeah, it's just
he's playing
just insane,
shows right
man.
Now
But yeah, hey, you want to take a quick break?
Yeah,
and,
let's do that.
Catch our breath. So for folks out there watching and or listening, I was doing this like my mind was blown. I said something like I'm trying to find a mic to drop. I drop a pen, and then John shows back up. He ain't hung up yet. I'm like, so I look like a complete douchebag.
Hey,
if he was watching or listening, but I'm a huge fan, and that was such a. I said it on the Zoom with him. Such a thrill for you and I, and I could have really nerded out, and I mean go into the Dukes and the specifics and different things, but I know he wants to talk about. This is my opinion. He didn't say this, but I'm sure he wants to talk about things other than Dukes of Hazzard.
He still has the Bo extravaganza. So I'm sure. I mean, you know, it's. But I mean, if you played a bad guy serial killer in a TV show 30, 40 years ago, you probably wouldn't want to talk about it. But he's Bo Duke. Got to talk about it. He seems like a great guy. My buddy Brandon, like we talked about, who's the one that introduced us, he told me beforehand, he said, you and Justin are going to love this guy. He said he's right up y'all's alley. He's a talker. He's fun. He's, you know, so anyway, spot on. But, yeah, if you want to real quick, Just, if you want to drop Kate's store info on him one time.
Yeah, and just want to say that – we discussed it last week, maybe the week before, something like that. But we own a couple of clothing boutiques. There's a women's clothing boutique called SoCo. We also have a children's clothing boutique called This Little Piggy. The website is shopthislittlepiggy.com. That is shopthislittlepiggy.com. Go on there. You can find them on all social media, including Instagram, Facebook, all of them, at shopthislittlepiggyar. Shopthislittlepiggyar. Either Ross was making a joke or he wasn't. I don't know. So I'll say it anyway. Ross is our business partner, but certified goofball. TikTok, no doubt. At ShopTLP. ShopTLP. I don't know if we have a TikTok or not. I have no idea.
Please tell me you do. I don't have a TikTok app, but I'll find it if we've got one of them knuckleheads cutting up.
And we ship anywhere. Anywhere in the world, really. We've shipped outside the country where we can. And so, yeah, if you got to buy clothes or you got to buy Christmas presents, there's toys. There's all kinds of stuff. And they'll put baskets, gift baskets together. They do all kinds of, we have embroidery machine.
Yeah, I say, yeah, go to the site. Cool
shop
stuff.
ShopThisLittlePiggy.com. ShopThisLittlePiggy.com.
There you go. And we're going to take a real short break, and we'll be back soon here on the Justin Moore Podcast. But I just want to say thank you to everybody for joining us on this journey that is the Justin Moore Podcast, because we didn't know where it was going to go, and it's only been going up since we started, and that's a direct correlation to you guys spreading the love, hitting like, hitting subscribe, hitting the notification button on all those platforms. So continue to do so, and leave us some comments, and buy some merch, and just thank you so much, everybody out there. Welcome, everyone, back to the Justin Moore Podcast. You're here on episode 12 of season 2. We had on earlier with us the fantastic John Schneider, a.k.a. Bo Duke, a.k.a. the hardest working man in the South, North, East, and West. So thank you again to Schneider for jumping on. Look forward to catching up with him again some point on podcast and in real life. Can't wait to hang out with him. And before we left, you guys, we dropped the Shop Little Piggy info on you, the website stuff. And I had one I thought about, and I've had a note to have it, and I got lost in the shuffle earlier, but keeping our wives off our butts, I got to mention this too, as far as things like that. Anybody looking to buy real estate in Louisiana or Alabama, that's what my wife does. So if anyone wants to buy or sell real estate in Louisiana or Alabama and doesn't have an agent, my wonderful, beautiful bride, Charisse, would be happy to assist you in your home buying or selling journey. So just want to put that out there as well. But okay, everybody, go ahead.
I was going to say, don't make the same mistake as me. Does she have like handles and website and name and all that?
She does, but I'm going to mess it up. So go to my website, and I'll have a link on my website to all of her stuff. Go. So
that's what I did the first time.
I know. That's why I thought about it. I said, oh, better get that in. So, and everybody, ridiculous. Remember to go to johnschneiderstudios.com or John Schneider on all the social media handles to check his stuff out. And I'll put the links up to his movie and that kind of stuff and music on the show notes. Had a quick something I wanted to run down. Number one song in country music this week was by Mr. Michael Hardy, a Mississippian. He goes by Hardy, but Michael Hardy's his name. I know he runs with Morgan and Ernest and that bunch. And I don't think I've ever met him, but I've heard good things about him and his stuff. And he had a song which he had Lauren Elena on and Devin Dawson on. So he enlisted some of his buddies to jump on the song. And they had the number one song this week. So congrats to you guys.
Apparently, I'm going to have to get Lauren Elena on a song. It seems like she has a number one duet song.
Yeah, she's the hit. Like, she might be the catalyst to the hit makers. I know.
I don't know. I got to maybe get her on a song or something.
I know.
She's a really good singer, though.
Oh,
really
yeah.
Good singer. Oh, I love her voice.
Oh, yeah. As good as they get, and a sweetheart, really pretty and super cool. And I've never met Devin either. I listened to him on a podcast recently, though. He seems like a cool cat and wrote a bunch of, he was one of the writers on God's Country, which song mm-hmm. you and I both loved. But
Hardy's written a bunch of hits.
Yeah.
I couldn't name them right now off the top of my head, but I know he's written a number of them.
Yeah, that's a kind of new faction of riders in town. Like I said, Hardy and Devin and Morgan and Jameson Rogers and Luke Combs.
Kind of the generation kind of after us.
Yeah, you know? Pretty much after all. Yeah, after your whole bunch. So congrats to all those guys. And I don't have the charts with me in front of me. I just wrote that down because I saw it on the Morning Hangover. Shout out Kurt Burdell in the Morning Hangover this morning. So I wanted to say that. Usually Pete, our manager, sends me the charts this week, but I don't have them. But I'd safely say I think you're sitting at 41 this week, 42 this week maybe.
41, yeah, officially. 41. Should go inside the top 40. Well, this week. We're at 41 this week, but that's for – so the chart reports, for those out there who care about this nerdy stuff, but a chart reports from the week prior, obviously, so – Last week we ended at 41. This week we should be inside the top 40, which is kind of a milestone thing. And I think I've had one single in my career not get inside the top 40, which is kind of amazing.
Yeah, no doubt.
Ever in my career.
Out of what, probably 18 songs you've put out?
I was going to look that up, actually, JR, because we got to be getting close to 20.
Yeah, because I mean, I'm just thinking, since I've been with you, you've put out...
What are we, 6 albums in?
Yeah.
Something like... We got to be getting close.
I mean, because I know you've charted 10 songs since I've known you in the past 7 years or whatever.
So...
At least.
But yeah, point being, yeah, our song is... I've said this for a couple of weeks in a row. I think it's our fastest moving single ever, which is... I don't really know what to attribute that to, but... I will take it.
I think it's because you. I think it's because you referenced John Schneider in your song. Hey, and how funny is that? You know, last week we didn't think about it until Heath brought it to attention. We were talking about our favorite holiday side dishes for Thanksgiving and green bean casserole, which is in a song. And then today, our guest, who happens to be referenced in your newest song, maybe that's a new underlying theme we didn't even know, like Lauren Elena being on number ones. Maybe you reference things in songs enough it comes up on the podcast, you know. Next, maybe we'll have Hank Jr. next week, you never know.
You never know.
Boy, could
you mentioned James. Oh goodness. You mentioned Jameson. I think we may try to get Jameson on the podcast as well. Another guy we haven't, or I haven't met. Maybe you have. I hadn't
yet. We talked on DMs a little bit the other day. Super cool guy. I know some people who know him said he's super cool. I know he's Heath, who we had on last week. Heath Sanders, our good buddy. He runs with a lot of that newer generation, even though he's closer to our age. He's in that new bunch of stuff. He kind of runs with those guys. But yeah, that'd be a good one to have on as well. And we still got to get Morgan on. I heard him on Theo Vaughn's podcast the other day, which they were funny. And he's right there with us as far as getting back and playing. And I know we had talked to him earlier in the year, and he was busy. And we just want to make sure we have plenty of time. And would have done that with John, but his movie just coming out, I felt it was important to go ahead and get him on and talk about it. Mm-hmm. But maybe we'll have some of those guys on the beginning of next season, because we've only got a couple episodes left for this season. Yeah. I think we've kind of got a plan on what we want to do, but as any of you guys who've been listening for long enough know, Justin and I's plans are never officially in concrete until the week after the concrete has set. So, I had a question I wanted to ask for you guys. I didn't know. I saw on social media this past weekend that our little buddy Colt Barrett got his first buck, and I was going to see how it was going with the girls. Did you get to get any of the girls and Kate out any this past week or so?
Yeah. Did I tell you about the deer that I saw on camera? Did I tell you that whole story?
Talked about was you had Kate and she had the video of the doe that might have been a buck, but I don't think I've got any hunt stories since then.
Okay. Yeah. So the kids, unfortunately, this particular week that we're in, we're virtual because of COVID. Hopefully the kids get to go back next week. But yeah, so Thanksgiving week happened, obviously. and we didn't. We just did it by ourselves. We hadn't even talked about Thanksgiving. What'd you guys do?
Well, we have pretty low key. Jamie and them were going to come up, but we didn't get our plans in order and couldn't find a house that could keep his dogs because my brother and his wife and my young nephew, who's just turned one, they also have three ginormous dogs and a couple of cats. So when they travel, it's tough. And we just didn't plan on the dogs and stuff. So Jamie and them didn't get to come. But my mom came down. And she spent 4 or 5 days with us, and, you know, she's a hoot. So her and Charisse just nonstop nonsense.
Drank wine.
Oh, yeah, drank Trulies and wine and beers and then Bushwhackers. And her new favorite thing is these key lime coladas they have at the Floribama. So we had to drive over there about four times a day to keep her stocked up on them key lime coladas. She came out of the yacht club one time with so many damn frozen drinks. I was like, Mom, there's three of us on the boat. She said, well, I didn't know how long we was going to ride, you know, because
I love your mom.
Oh, she's a hoot. She loves you too. She loves all. She asks about South and the girls every time, of course. So I show her the pictures.
Give
me
that baby.
Yeah, give me the baby. And your dad sent me some cute pictures of Thanksgiving, so I showed her those. And but yeah, we got to go out on the boat one morning, which is different for us. Usually we're afternoon boat riders, but with the sun going down so early now, we got up and went early one day, which actually we had a blast. You know, we got out there about 9 and stayed till about 1 and had a good time. And it was weird because it was a lot of fog down here, which we normally don't have it like that, but I posted a video on Instagram, but it was this eerie fog for 2 or 3 days, and it wasn't like a real misty fog, and you could see in front of you, but it, say 50 yards in front of you, couldn't see anything, and it stayed that way for like 2 days. It almost looked like smoke. It was weird, but we got to go out on the boat, yeah, and do a few things. Nothing major. We didn't even cook a bird. We did a huge roast. Charisse made gumbo and potato salad, which, you know, mom was like, well,
how did you pull that off?
Mom, I let mom bring it up and steer the ship. I was like, well, Charisse is like, I don't know. I'm like, well, I mean, I'm good either way, but, you know, mom kind of wanted it. So
I told you earlier in the show that it was cold here. So a couple of days ago, Kate made gumbo. She just offered. I was like, okay, yeah,
well,
that'd be great.
Well, if it's not too much trouble, honey.
She gets her roux going and everything, and her, you know, all the celery and onions and bell pepper, all that going, and what they call it, the Holy Trinity or whatever.
Holy Trinity, yeah.
She had all that going, and she goes, y'all sure? She tells me and the girl, she goes, y'all sure y'all don't want chicken stew? Because it's right at that moment, which I love chicken stew, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
It's right at that moment where you got to say, we're like, no, gumbo, let's do gumbo. Yeah.
She do chicken, so, and chicken and sausage?
Chicken and sausage, yeah. It was really good.
That's what Charisse made.
I'm still eating it. I've eaten it for the last 7 meals, be honest with you.
Same. I had it for dinner last night when I got home, and I told Charisse, and I wasn't knocking any of her other attempts, but that might be one of the best ones she ever did. It was a blonde roux, and man, yeah, it was fantastic. So.
But Thanksgiving wise, we didn't get together, and it really had nothing to do with anything other than I have an elderly grandmother who has COPD and an elderly grandfather who's basically had everything you can have. I mean, one of them is 90, and one of them is, you know, 86 or something, you know. So we just decided, better safe than sorry, because of the school being out, because, you know, whatever. We could go down that rabbit hole, but we decided better safe than sorry. So, yeah. But Kate mentioned making a gumbo for Thanksgiving, and I love gumbo. But Thanksgiving is my favorite holiday, first of all. Second of all, Thanksgiving food is my favorite food. Like, I told Kate, I go, If I were on death row, that would be my last meal, period. Yeah. I mean, and so I'm like, oh, no, even though it's just us, we're doing Thanksgiving food.
Right.
And I said, you can do gumbo a couple of days from now, which she ended up doing. But I fry turkey. Well, I usually fry two, but I only did one this year. But green bean casserole. I made a big pot of white beans, sweet potato casserole, corn dressing, hash brown potatoes. I know, mean, we do the whole bit. You know, we did it all.
I know Kate reached out to Charisse, and Charisse is going to make us some, but she reached out to Charisse about a recipe for the corn pudding that they used to do at the Voodoo Barbecue down there in Louisiana.
Yeah, yeah, that was it. And Charisse, and there's really honestly nothing to it. You know me, I cook. So yeah, I'm right. like, I mean, I could really kind of make this better. I mean, it's not, it must be a nostalgia thing.
It's their thing down there. Well, even
it's Charisse, nothing but cornbread with corn in it. That's all it was. If I put some cheese and some hamburger meat or some deer meat in this and a jalapenos and I could really, and she's like, no, it's great the way it is. I'm like, well, it's cornbread. I love cornbread, but I mean, with kernels of corn in it, but right. I mean, it's good. So I just used it as cornbread. I'd sop my bean juice up with it, you know, whatever. Well,
it's fun topic because, you know, my favorite is dressing, which I didn't get to get any this year because it's a hard deal. And my grandmother's is my favorite. Everything my grandmother's has ever cooked for me in my life is just what I grew up on. It's just what, like you said,
ain't fit to eat, though.
No, you know, might as well just throw it on out. But my last meal, would probably have to be a big plate of stuff my grandmother made for Thanksgiving. But I did talk to my grandmother, and after I come and see you this weekend and we go play at Billy Bob's on next Monday the 7th, I'm going to stop back by Gran's on the way home, and we're going to – same thing. Gran's in her 80s, so we're going to keep our distance, which is going to be weird. But I'm going to stop by. I've got a few tools in my granddad's tool shed I need to get for some projects down here. And she's making me – some dressing to bring home with me. So I'm going to get my dressing, but just a little late. But yeah, and so talking about dressing, we were talking about it with Charisse, you know, and
my mom always makes a dressing.
Yeah,
for
and
us.
Mom
go
was
ahead.
Interested sorry. About Charisse and then what they do for Thanksgiving, because typically down there, it's nothing like we eat for Thanksgiving, really.
No.
I mean, it's gumbo for Thanksgiving and some ham and maybe some turkey and stuff, but they do a rice dressing. So Charisse was saying, we do rice dressing.
That's good stuff, too.
But when you think about dressing like we know it, it's not even the same thing. It's more like rice Roni, really. It's rice and beef and ground beef. So it's not really a dressing. The dressing to me is cornbread. It's just not the same thing. But to them, that's what they call dressing.
It's good.
It's great.
Don't get me wrong. Everything they cook is good.
Yeah, it's way better than rice Roni. But it's just to me.
But
it's all.
This is all it is. It's rice, ground beef, and the Holy Trinity. That's all it is. It's good. It's really good. But that's all it is. I mean, I'll eat the snot out of it.
Oh, yeah, all day. But to me, dressing is a bread-based thing, whether it's, you know, stuffing they do off different places or our cornbread dressing. Which
we don't call it stuffing.
That's a northern thing. But stuffing to them is like sage, and it's like breadcrumbs and stuff they use. I don't even think they do cornbread in their stuffing, because I've had that off places. But for us, same as you probably, cornbread dressing is cornbread. You make loaves of cornbread, and then you mash it up, and you put all the stuff in it. And I know my favorite thing, and Charisse thinks it's gross, and probably other people do, is giblet gravy, which is all the little innards and stuff. Gran makes this gravy out of all the stuff, and you take your little ladle, and it'll have whole boiled eggs and little hunks of this and that, and you take that gravy and put it over top of that dressing.
So good.
Oh my God, get out of here.
Yeah, so you
make me hungry.
I love how you talk Gran into stopping by.
Yeah, I was like, I gotta stop by and say, well, she actually, unfortunately, my Uncle Wayne, one of her last few brothers left out of the 11 brothers and sisters she had, passed away last week, unfortunately.
Aww.
Yeah, Uncle Wayne, he was a good one. I know him and Pedro up in heaven cutting it up and telling some stories right now. Them two were peas in a pod. That was his best buddy. But and Gran's big brother, you know, that was her guy. But she got to go to the funeral. And that's the first time she'd been out of the house, really. Her and Aunt Paula they've quarantined, and they do a pretty good job socially distancing themselves in general without 2020. But this year even more so. But she went to the funeral and saw a bunch of our cousins and her nieces and nephews and stuff. And she wore her mask, and it was outside, but she told me on the phone, she was like, you know, I was really not wanting to hug everybody, but she said by the end of it, I think I had hugged everybody there. And I'm like, well, you just got to. And then, you know, her, she's tough old bird. She goes, well, and hell, at this point, I'm 80. If anybody's going to get it and die, I'd just rather it be me than any of y'all. You know how sweet she is, you know. But I'm like, Lord, don't say that, grandmother. But point being, she got to see some family and touch and embrace and interact. And like going back to what Schneider was saying, it brought a lot of joy to her. And I think it's made her rethink this whole thing a little bit, because she's like a lot of Americans that just sit at home and watch the evening news every night and are just scared to death, that because that's all they know. There's they're not interacting with anybody. They're looking at the numbers that they're being provided and, you know, things like that. So I think she's loosening up a little bit. We couldn't talk her into coming down or us going to her house for Thanksgiving, but there's hope for Christmas possibly.
Y'all could put her even like, I mean, just like Christmas, for example. I mean, she could stay in the back house by herself, couldn't she? And then, like, we get together to eat or whatever. I mean,
I would think, but it's just weird. And Aunt Paula, you know, she had a surgery a month or so ago, so I think she's not 100% for getting around yet. But we're working on it, and she's loosened up a little bit. So I am going to stop by and see her, and we'll see how that goes. I'll make sure to get a couple of selfie type pictures and stuff. But yeah, I'm hopeful for Christmas we're going to all be able to get together. For that at least. And I had a good idea I brought up to Mom and my brother James about maybe getting her an iPad, because, you know, her and Aunt Paula still have flip phones. I mean, there's no iPhones over there. There's no smartphones in their house. There's no internet. There's no cable. Never has been. I mean, it's still the same channels when I was growing up, except for I don't have to go up there and turn the dial like I used to. We're thinking about getting her an iPad that's set to cellular service, just like a new phone line, but an iPad.
Yeah.
And
have it simply, so y'all can FaceTime.
Exactly. She could, because my brother sends, he's good about it. He sends videos to us every morning of my nephew playing, which is a hoot.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Oh, yeah, chasing
the dogs.
It
doesn't surprise me out of Jamie.
Oh, dude, Jamie is daddy daycare. Let me tell you how proud I am of my little brother. He's got the boy. He's got the three grown, huge, 150-pound Cane Corso dogs. Every morning at like 6:30, he gets up, gets the little boy up fed, gets the dogs, takes the dogs to the dog park, and lets the little boy play every morning. I mean, it's before he goes to work, he goes to the gym every day. He works a full-time job, make good money, and
he would have been a badass Navy SEAL.
Oh yeah. He'd pretty much be, and he would be G.I. Jamie, is what I used to call him. And he would be pretty much good at anything, as we know. But I'm really proud of him for him stepping up. And his wife does a great job, too. But him making sure to do more than just the minimum with my nephew.
He takes him above and beyond.
Yeah, he takes him out there to the park while the dogs are playing. And my little nephew's chasing the dogs, and he's splashing in the mud puddle after them. And he's just a smile, and his hair's getting long. Now he looks like the fifth beetle, because we hadn't got Charisse to – they're waiting on Charisse to cut his hair. So, he kills it with that. But, yeah, that's the plan. Get her an iPad that way, and make it simple enough to where – there's nothing else on it, just that. When it rings, you hit the answer thing, and it's ready to go for her. So I'm hoping maybe I can get that set up for her and get that to her before Christmas. So if we don't get to do Christmas together, we'll set that up, and we'll Zoom and talk on the Zoom machine with Gran and Paula that way. So I'm thinking that might be an option.
Yeah, I wanted to touch on Thanksgiving, but I wasn't trying to avoid your question about the deer hunting. But, yeah, I'm glad y'all had a good Thanksgiving. But, the long story short – so this was, I don't know, this time last week I told Ella, I go, hey, why don't you get up in the morning with me and go hunting? Well, Kate had planned on taking the other girls or whoever wanted to go, to get their nails done and this and that. And I thought, well, Ella, she'll want to go hunting, you know, Ella, get up and go hunting with me.
Yeah.
Well, she's like, Dad, any day but tomorrow, she want to go get her nails done. This and that. I'm like, all right. And so I got up. I didn't get up and go at daylight. I got up, I don't know, and went at 7:30 or something like that, 8:00. Well, I took South with me. So all the girls went and did their thing. Me and him go to deer woods. And a buck that I had last year, a 10-point that I had last year that I knew didn't get shot. So I knew he would still be there. That's just the way it works, you know.
Yep.
I knew it would still be there, so I've been trying to figure out how to hunt that deer this year, because I know he's an older buck. I figured last year he was 4 or 5. I thought, well, I can tell this year once I get him on camera. I ain't had him on camera any. So I go, and me and South go, and we check the cameras. That deer, we get there at, say, 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning. Once we actually get out to where we're going, that deer was there for the first time all year. was there at 7:28 a.m. The day after I begged Ella the night before. I'm like, come on, let's go hunt in the morning. Let's go hunt in the morning. If you want to kill deer, you've got to hunt. You can't just go and then you don't see nothing and then you don't go back. Because, you know, I explained how all of her little friends killed one youth hunt. I'm like, you got to hunt.
Yep.
If you really want to. I ain't seen that deer until that day. And it was 7:28. So we would have got to the stand at 6 o'clock.
Been right on time.
She would have killed it by 7:30. The deer stood out there. We can hunt over a feeder in Arkansas. I know some states out there you can't.
Yeah, Alabama as well. We can.
But we can. That deer stood out there for 40 minutes.
Oh my God! How big is he now?
Same deer. I think he's an 8 point this year. So he's going down. So he needs to be shot this
right.
year.
Right. He's probably, what, 7, 8 years old?
I think he's probably a 6-year-old deer.
Right.
I mean, I'm just guessing.
Right.
5, 6, 7, somewhere in that range. But he's going down.
So it's time to take him for sure.
He needs to be shot. Well, I can show you a picture of him,
and
actually.
Dang, that would have been Ella's first deer, a monster.
First deer, big, for here, a big deer. Yeah. Now, I've killed really big deer.
Yeah, I mean, off places.
There's
yeah.
two college helmets hanging on a deer that I mean big deer. I don't care about. I mean, I want to kill this deer just because I've been hunting this deer for 2 years. Well, but I'd rather her kill it.
Yeah, it's wildlife resource management at this
so
point.
Here you go. So that's him last year.
Dang, nice.
He's
big,
not
thick
real
neck.
Tall. He's yeah, not real tall, but he's wide.
Yeah, he's thick. Yeah.
This is him this year. I think he's an 8 point. I think he's a little wider.
Oh, his neck. Yeah, swollen.
But
up.
He's a big deer. Anyway. I'm just like,
oh man.
So I've hunted the next couple of days, and I ain't kidding you, man. And I tried to get her to go with me. Nah, whatever. She don't really want to go, apparently. And she thinks she's disappointing me. I'm like, honey, I don't care. You can be into this or you don't have to be into it. You came to me and told me, like, Dad, I got to kill a deer. If you don't want to, fine. So I went the next morning, and this little forked horn walked out. No kidding, JR. 15 feet from the stand.
What?
And just stood there in a mud puddle.
Oh,
just stood
my.
There. And I'm like, it'd be perfect.
Where is
and
Ella?
Then a little doe walked out on the other side. 15 feet from this. I'm just like, oh my God.
Y'all could have doubled up.
Oh my gosh.
Well, I know it's, so, she's got a lot going on. Well, hopefully she'll get out there with you and get her first. What about Kate? Yeah. She's holding off on getting back out there.
She hadn't been
too.
Back either.
Yeah.
And I don't want to get into this here, but Kate's been dealing with some health issues. Fortunately, we've gotten good reports. So she hasn't been feeling real well, but here's that little forked horn.
Hey, go ahead and tell everyone y'all aren't pregnant again, are you?
Oh God, no.
Okay.
No.
Just don't
I'm moving in with you if that's the case.
We'll get all the questions.
Here's how close the doe was. I took that and I'm not zoomed in at all.
Oh my gosh.
That's how close the doe was.
Well,
here's a little forked horn.
Just right there.
So he walked over to that little mud puddle and just stood there.
Wow.
Just like crazy.
For y'all listening that can't see this, go over to YouTube and go.
Yeah, you can check this out. This would be a good thing to sell you guys on watching this thing.
Yeah.
Here's my fried turkey from Thanksgiving.
Dang, son. I saw a YouTube video or a thing that some guy trying to fry his turkey had just burnt one to a crisp. Everybody see that?
I saw that.
Golly, that guy. Woo,
like he must have cooked that joker for like hours.
And he pulled it
out. It
only
takes him. That was a 13-pound turkey, and I cooked it for like 45 minutes maybe or something.
Yeah. Yeah. He pulled it out. He's pulling it out slow, like he's got the prize.
It's black as coal.
Oh yeah, and I wonder if when they cut it open, it was like on the Griswolds where they cut it went poof and a puff of dust flew out of it.
It's funny you say that because I was cleaning the bird and washing it and before I cooked it and the neck comes out.
Yeah,
and. And I was thinking, save the neck for me, Clark. But, oh, my God. Kennedy, our crazy one out there, our second daughter who just turned nine. But I'm opening the thing, the giblets and all that. You know, it comes in it.
Or, yeah.
And she goes, is that the balls? me and Kate are just like, oh, how do you not laugh at that?
You got to. It's just so ridiculous. No, not exactly,
but,
honey.
But anyway, so yes, we're hunting this one deer, back to the hunting, and I haven't seen it on the hoof yet, but I've got pictures of it this year. So I was right in what I thought, that he was an older deer and that he was still in there. And so I guess I'm going to have to kill it because nobody wants to go back with me. So I guess it's all on me.
If I get up there Saturday morning in time, or Saturday night in time, yeah, maybe Sunday morning, I can get me one. That might be my only chance.
Go.
I'm gonna bring my rifle. We'll try to make that happen because we're probably, yeah. I don't know if we'll head to, well, we need to figure that out.
If you, I might have an extra one if you don't want to.
Oh yeah, you maybe we can scrounge around and find something. I need to shoot that rifle. I need to sight it in first because I hadn't.
But
shot
yeah, that deer is there,
year.
And there are three other bucks in there that are you know, yeah, shootable.
Well,
bucks.
I'm like you. I'm hunting for meat. I'm trying to fill up the freezer. So I mean, I'm,
well, what I normally do personally is I wait until I hunt a deer. Or a couple of whatever. And then at close to the end of the season, I'll kill me a couple of does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's why
I know I can go do that about any time.
Right.
So.
Right. Yeah. And my options are pretty limited this year. I'm going to try to get my good buddy J-Mac or Chad Jones one to take me in Eclectic some point later this or beginning of January or sometime soon, whenever I can talk one of them into it. But my opportunities are kind of limited. You got to drive a little north of down here to be in any hunting land, which we're working on that. I'm going to look at some property Friday that Jamie and I may buy some acreage on the Florida-Alabama line and stick Dad out there and have us a little hunting fishing camp. So I'm going to look at that land.
Stick him out there and build him a cabin.
Yeah, 16 acres. It's got access to the Perdido River, which runs into the bay eventually. But yeah, I told a friend of mine who's got the land. It was his father's land before he passed a couple years ago, and I said, I'm not worried about my dad, people bothering my dad. I'm worried about my dad bothering people. So I want to put him in the middle of these 16 acres so he doesn't bother anybody else. And so I'm gonna go look at that Friday. So I'm pumped about that.
If that eventually gets to the bay, he'll be like freaking Huck Finn on your doorstep.
Yeah, I'll hear somebody there. Justin, look, what is that noise coming from?
I built this raft.
Yeah, yeah.
And I go out there. I floated down the river to the bay and
to the
made
intercoastal.
My way over
yeah.
here.
I'll be like, what is that noise? And I walk over the intercoastal. There's Dad on a raft. He's done made it. I just come see if you had any coffee. I done run out. I need coffee. I'm like, well, you passed everything. But anyway, so that should be fun. But yeah, so I may do that. I'm gonna try to get to your house early enough Saturday where I can get some good rest. Maybe we can go Sunday, but I'm pumped about getting
no
to see
doubt
you.
Let's do it. Yeah. That'd be great. Let's
yeah
do
we
it.
Need to and I, so I'm pumped about seeing the kiddos as well and going to do a show. God, excited about that. Wish we had a handful more for the years out, but excited about that. So by the time this airs, you'll have time to go on if you hadn't yet and get some tickets to go to Billy Bob's. It's limited capacity, but I do know there are 50 or 60 GA tickets they just re-released, so there are some tickets out there. So go to Billy Bob's website or go to justinmooremusic.com and go on the tour page. And
yeah,
find
please
the link
come
to that.
See us. This will be the last opportunity you have to come see us. Last opportunity we have to play a show until at least April.
Yeah.
So if you're anywhere close to that area,
and Dallas
come,
is pretty accessible. From
come see us.
A lot of the country, you know, Dallas is a couple of hours from a lot of places. So yeah,
and Billy Bob's, if you haven't been there, or if you have, I mean, you know, but it's such a special venue.
Yeah,
I mean, we've talked about that with multiple artists. I think most recently Joe Nichols, but it's such a cool place. So yeah, if you're in the area, please come see us. If you're, you know, able to drive a few hours or whatever and you want to make a weekend of it or whatever, we're looking forward to it. Certainly. We haven't played in a while. And it'll be our last show of the year. So
yeah. I tell people, I'm like, it's kind of friends over at the Floribama ask me what Billy Bob's are like, because they always kind of come in the same topic or conversation as far as five-star honky-tonks and super clubs and that kind of stuff, which Buck Owens Crystal Palace, which I'm wearing the shirt right now, would be one. Coyote Joe's, the Dusty Armadillo, Joe's on Weed Street. I mean, you know, there's 10 or 12 all over the country that have just been around for a long time.
8 Seconds Saloon. 8 Seconds and Indy.
Yeah. But few more iconic than Billy Bob's that are still around than Billy Bob's in the Floribama. And I kind of say Floribama is like a beach bar version of Billy Bob's, and Billy Bob's is like a rodeo version of the Floribama. So if that tells you anything, multiple stages, lots of bars, big place, must see. And then I know you're as excited about it as I am going across the street to Cooper's and getting some barbecue while we're there.
And you know me, I'm not even a big barbecue guy.
Yeah.
But
they got it going on over there.
Amazing.
And I don't know,
if all barbecue was like that, I would love barbecue.
Yeah. And I don't, and we're going to try to bring our equipment, and we may record a live podcast, or not live, but record our podcast from the grounds of the
stockyards. Fingers crossed, we might have a really cool guest. We're working on it.
Yep. Working on that. Somebody in that area. So y'all make sure to come see us on that. By the time this comes out, you'll still have time to get some tickets. I don't know if you got anything else to touch on, Just, but I had a few this day in country.
No, I knew
music.
You had some stuff to touch on, but I did want to touch on Thanksgiving. You asked me about hunting, so I got us off on a tangent.
Yep, no, that's good. And we'll crank up the Christmas talk next week on the podcast. So y'all all tune back in here to your favorite podcast, the Justin Moore Podcast, on your favorite listening device, whether that be Google Podcast, iTunes, YouTube, all that good stuff. And if you're having trouble getting to YouTube or finding anything, everything we do, I post on my website. So you can go to jrthehandler.com, and there's links to everything. You can go on the podcast page, and I post the actual videos right there. So you don't have to go to YouTube. You can click, and if you want to click on it there, it'll take you to the YouTube page. But that's an easy way if you're not too savvy on all that stuff, because I wasn't, and you and I have talked about it. Before all the pandemic stuff, I was, you know, maybe a 1 or 2 level of being able to do all this social media and internet stuff, and I'm about a 4 now. So, but we've got stuff up for everybody, so y'all go check that out. And I had something that our good friend Todd Dink, who if you guys need something else to listen to outside of the country music genre, a real fun podcast that I listen to weekly. It's called Every Playlist Tells a Story, and our good buddy Todd posed a question, kind of going along with our Mount Rushmore of country music thing we've done on here, which I wanted, if we had more time, we would ask John his Mount Rushmore of country music, which we'll save that for next time he joins us. But he had a good one I thought would be fun to ask you and I on here when it's just us, and maybe we can do it as a reoccurring thing. But he said, what are 3 songs when you go into a bar that you hope are on the jukebox? And if they're on the jukebox, you know you're at the right bar. I thought that was a good question. And I wish I could pull up what
that is a good question.
What he sent me. Let me see if I can find one.
That's a good
Todd
question.
Sent me on that, because he had 3 good ones.
I mean, I could spit out 3 real quick.
Yeah, go ahead. Todd's were, this is his exact text he sent me, along the lines of Mount Rushmore greatest country groups question, what are the top 3 country songs you want to see on a jukebox in a bar? He's going with Charlie Daniels Band, Devil Went Down to Georgia, Merle Haggard, Mama Tried, and Loretta Lynn's Don't Come Home A-Drinking with Loving on Your Mind. He said, okay, top 5, 3 is too damn hard. Charlie Pride, Kiss an Angel, Good Morning, and Hank Jr., Family Tradition. Which, all 5, yeah. I have to say, one for me, being on a jukebox, one that I know if it comes on, I'm at the right place, is Bubba Shot the Jukebox by Mark Chestnut. That's always a good one if it's on the box.
Well.
And having John Schneider on brings up another one. Just the good old boys. Oh, and I forgot to tell Schneider that you play that song. That we play that song in the live show.
Yeah, we do.
So anyway,
that's a great question.
Let's think
one
on that.
One that I know. Well, hold on. Let me tune this guitar, because one that I know for a fact has to be there.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you want to, Just, we'll think about these, and I'll come up with a list on my own. If you want to play us out, we've been on here for a while now. Let's go ahead and let you play us out on one. I'll do my reading, and we'll call it a day for today, because I've got to go call everybody I knew growing up and tell them I just talked to Bo Duke. My mom texted me this morning because I told her last night that's who we're recording with today. And she texted me early this morning, are you excited? I said, like I'm a little kid, you know. I'm like, yes, ma'am. So excited.
I know. I text my group of friends.
Which I normally never would. Not that no one's not impressed by all the, you know, stars we've had on here. But anyway. So
yeah,
here,
so y'all gotta excuse me. I got to go interview Bo Duke.
Yeah, so Justin's going to play you a tune that he hopes is on the jukebox when he walks in and we know we're at the right bar. Then I'm going to play you, or I'm going to read you a reading. I know I missed that last week. I apologize, but I'm going to make up for it right here. But thank you guys for tuning in once again this week to the Justin Moore Podcast. We'll see you guys real soon. Take it away, Just.
I tell you what, JR, I'll play you the last verse of a song that has to be on every jukebox.
Okay.
Well, I was drunk. Ate my mom.
No doubt.
Got out of prison. And I went to pick her up in the rain. But before I could get to the station in my pickup truck, got run over by a dang no train. So hang around as long as you will let me. And I never minded standing in the rain. Something like that.
Oh yeah, yep,
that's that gotta be on a jukebox though.
Got I mean, to.
Come on
now. All right, everybody. We'll see y'all next week.
See you guys. Thanks so much.
Cheers. Chapter 29. Words with meaning. Pleasant words are a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and healing to the bones. Proverbs 16:24. I never let a day go by without telling my wife that I love her, usually several times a day. Not that she doesn't already know it, because we've been married for 54 years. Despite the fact that I'm 82 and she's 75, we hug a lot, hold hands, snuggle, and constantly speak endearments to each other. Many days, except for the 3 hours my on-the-road concert schedule demands, we are together 24 hours and never tire of each other's company. Our son, Charlie, is in his 50s, and he always hugs his mother and me every time he comes to our house. Even at the end of a telephone conversation, we always say, I love you. I can't remember a time in my childhood when greeting kinfolk and friends of the family didn't involve a hug. It was just something you did naturally, just a part of saying hello. I am of the opinion that hugs and words of affection are healing. I don't think there's enough of either in today's society. I hug my employees if I haven't seen them for a while. I even hug someone I'm meeting for the first time if it seems fitting. As long as I've lived, my little corner of the world will always be an affectionate place. An apt word and a good hug can make up for a lot of ill feelings. Let's all make the day count.
The Justin Moore Podcast is directed by Brian Hill, a production of Sport and Story, L3 Entertainment, and Rebel Rooster. Thanks to everyone who helps make this happen.